Okay, so this is a tutorial for the geometry summer packet if you were having trouble with that and you needed some help with it. I'm just going to go through a couple problems on each of the topics so you can get an idea of how to complete that particular section. So the first topic is simplifying square roots. So a couple notes on square roots. The first thing is it's important to know when they're talking about simplifying each radical by hand, we want to break this radical down into a simplified version where we're taking out all of the perfect squares, because a perfect square rooted is going to give us a whole number. So let me just go through a couple of what the perfect squares are. So 1 squared would be 1, 2 squared is 2, I'm sorry, is 4, 3 squared is 9, and so on. So I'm just going to list our perfect squares up to 100. So 4 squared, 5 squared, 6 squared, 7 squared, 8 squared, 9 squared, and 10 squared. So what you want to do when you're doing this is you want to look for the largest perfect square factor for 96, or for the number underneath the radical. If you aren't sure what the perfect square factors are, then you can, with your calculator, just guess and check, okay? So if I put my calculator here, I have 96. Okay, I know 100 doesn't go into that. 81, no. I know 96 divided by, I would try 16 as a number that may go into 96, so let's do 96 divided by 16. Okay, it goes in evenly 6 times, so I can break 96 down into 16 times 6. Okay, when I do that, the square root of 16 is going to get multiplied by the square root of 6. The square root of 16 is a perfect square of 4. Okay, so if I was to complete this chart, 4 squared is equal to 16, which means the square root, the root that is squared is 4. The number that's squared to get to 16 was 4. So 4 is the square root of 16. And I will just bring down my square root of 6 that I didn't use. And since 6 doesn't have a perfect square factor that goes into it besides 1, this is as simplified as it can go. Okay, for the next example, for 216, again, we want to break it down. Occasionally, you'll get a perfect square, some number that multiplied by itself gives you this. In this case, that's not the, in this situation, that's not the case. So I would try again, 216, and I would try dividing it by something larger than I might think goes into it, so 64. It doesn't give me a whole integer, so I am not going to use 64. I would try 36 next. 216 divided by 36 gives me 6, which means the factors of 216 are 36 times 6. 36 is a perfect square of 6, so I can rewrite this as 30 square root of 36 times the square root of 6. Perfect square of 30, the square root of 36 is 6, so my answer is going to be 6 radical 6. Okay. And that's how you break down square roots. I will do one more where, let's do 72, the square of 72, where if I don't get the largest one on my first try, I can still break it down. So 72, I know that 3 goes into it, so I'll start with 3, so I break it down to 3 times 24. You can break it down to any two factors that multiply to give you that number. Okay, so 3 times 24, neither one of those are perfect squares, but that's okay. 3 is prime. I want to break 24 down, so I'm going to multiply, or figure out what numbers multiply to give me 24, and I know 6 times 4 gives me 24. I'm going to, again, I have one perfect square here. Square root of 4 is a perfect square, but in this case, I'm showing you really an alternate way to do it. This is the way that you would do it if you wanted to get to all the bottom prime numbers and then pull out pairs. Okay, so if I break down 3 is prime, so I'm just going to bring that one down. 6 breaks down into 3 times 2. 4 breaks down into 2 times 2. Okay, here we have all prime numbers. 3 is prime and 2 is prime. So I'm going to look at any pair of prime numbers comes out as an individual 3. So really what this is saying is that the square root of 9 is equal to 3. Okay, and in this part, this would come out, and I multiply it because they're both coming outside the square. The square root of 2 times 2, which is 4, is equal to 2. So a 3 comes on the outside as a result of these two 3s, a 2 comes on the outside as a result of these two 2s. So I have 6 on the outside when I multiply those together and the 2, 1, 2 remaining underneath the radical. So my answer would be 6 times the square root of 2. Okay, and that is how you do the simplifying square roots. Okay, moving on to the next topic, classifying angles. To classify each angle as acute, obtuse, right, or straight, all you're doing is looking to see if the measure of the angle is between 0 and 90 degrees, then it's acute. If it is between 90 and 180 degrees, it is obtuse. If it's exactly 90, it's right, and if it's 180 exactly, it's straight. Okay, you can't have an angle that's exactly 0, because that means that it's really just the same line. The two rays are actually overlapping each other, and you're not actually creating any space between them. Okay, so then you're just going to look to see if the angle is essentially larger than a corner of a paper, smaller than a corner of the paper, exactly of a corner of a paper, or a straight line. So this first one is larger than a corner of a sheet of paper, which would look like this if I was to make the corner. So that's 90, so this is larger than 90, which makes this an obtuse angle. This one, we're really just kind of roughly looking at this. This looks like a corner of a sheet of paper, so this is a right angle. Okay, the corner of the sheet of paper for number 17 would come here. This is not quite that degree, so we're going to label this one acute. And for 20, this one is straight, a straight angle. Okay, so this one, this page is pretty self-explanatory. Moving on to the back here, finding the midpoint of each line segment. Now, this is the part of the handout that these four graphs you don't need to show work for. Really, that's because you can look at the middle of the line segment pretty easily and tell it's right here. Okay, so my answer for this, the coordinates would be -3, because I'm going to go along the x first. So it's -3, -3. Again, the middle of the line, you want to find it, and it's going to be, if I go 1, 2, 3 units from the right point, and 1, 2, 3 units from the left point, I meet here, so this is my midpoint. It's -1, -2. On the bottom part, this part work is required for, because there's no graph given, so you can graph it and attach the graph. Or you can use the midpoint formula. So I'm going to label these x1, y1, x2, y2. That's just the first point's x and y coordinates, and the second point's x and y coordinates. Okay, in order to find the midpoint, the formula is x1 plus x2 divided by 2, comma y1 plus y2 divided by 2. You're finding the average of the x's, which is adding the two numbers together and dividing by how many numbers you add, which is 2. And the average of the y's. Okay, so in this case, -4 + 5/2 is going to be, if I substitute in -4 for x1 and 5 for x2, that's going to be my left side of my comma, my first coordinate expression, and the second one is going to be 4 + -1/2. Simplifying that, I get -4 + 5 = 1/2. 4 + -1 = 3/2, and since those don't divide evenly, I can leave my answer in fraction form. Okay. Okay, going down to 51 through 54. Finding the other endpoint of a line segment when we know one endpoint and the midpoint. Okay, this process is just lining them up. So it's E. E represents endpoint. I have endpoint at -1, -9. M is the midpoint. The midpoint is at -9, -10, and I'm looking for E, the other endpoint, because again, our segment's going to look something like this, where we have an endpoint, a midpoint, and another endpoint. So what you're essentially doing is seeing how far did we have to travel and in which direction for our x to go from -1 to -9. So -1 to -9 is a decrease of 8 units. So we went down -8 units. So I'm going to start at this -9, and I'm going to decrease 8 units to get to my x-coordinate for my other endpoint. So negative 9 minus 8 is negative 17. On the y-coordinate, from 9 to negative 10 is a decrease of 19 units. So I had to go down to get to negative 10. If I go down 9 units, I'm at 0. If I go down 10 more, I'm at negative 10. So I'm going to start now at negative 10, and I'm going to decrease 19 units. So negative 10 minus negative 19, or minus 19 is going to be negative 29. So that is my missing endpoints coordinates. If you graph this, it's a little easier to visualize, so I'm just going to sketch what this would look like. So negative 1, 9 is going to be somewhere here, and negative 9, negative 10 is going to be somewhere down here. Unfortunately, it's going to round up space on my graph. But what you're basically doing in this process that we've laid out here is figuring it out from the end to the middle, how much did it go to the left? And then we're going, figuring out for the y, from the end to the middle, how much did it go down? So the left, it went 8 units left, and the down, it went 19 units down. So then we repeat that process from M. So we start at M and we go 8 units left and 19 units down. So our ending point should be around here, which is negative 17, negative 29. So that's a good estimate for our answer, ballpark for our answer. Okay, moving on to topic 4, solving proportions. We want to leave our answer in as a fraction in simplest form. So to solve a proportion, if it's 6 over 2 equals 4 over p, we're going to cross multiply. So multiplying these gives us 6 times p equals, and then we're going to multiply our other side. 2 times 4 is going to give me 8. Okay, I need to get p alone, so I'm going to divide both sides by 6. So p is equal to 8 over 6, which simplifies to, these are both divisible by 2. So I can write this as 4 over 3. For 59 and 60, it wants us to, again, solve each proportion, but round our answer to the nearest hundredth. The hundredth place is, this is the tenths, this is the hundredth. So we're rounding it to the nearest hundredth. That should be in our answer. So when we cross multiply this, we get 7.7b equals 3.6 times 2.3. Okay, when I do that, 3.6 times 2.3 gives me 8.28, and I'm just bringing down the other side. Dividing that by 7.7 on both sides, you get b is equal to, okay, looking at this decimal, I have my tenths is 0, my hundredths is 7, so I'm looking at my thousandth place. If this is 5 or higher, I'm going to round this up to an 8, and my hundredths rounded would be 1.08. Okay, even though this is proportions, I'm going to do another example for this because these are slightly different than the ones that didn't have any addition with it. So when you cross multiply, it actually doesn't matter which side you do first. So I can do 8 times k plus 6 equals 9 times 6. At this point here, I'm going to distribute the 8 to both terms inside of the parentheses. So 8k plus 48 equals 54, and now I solve the linear equation. Subtracting 48 from both sides gives me 8k equals 6. Dividing 8 on both sides gives me that k is equal to 6/8, which simplified form, both of those are divisible by 2, so it's 3/4. OK, Okay, more of the same on the back. So starting at topic 5, which is circumference and area of circles. So to find the area of each circle, use your calculator's value for pi and round to the nearest tenth. So my area is equal to pi r squared. My radius in this case is 12. So I'm typing in my calculator. 12 squared is 144 times, and I'm going to use my pi button, my calculator's value for pi, so all of that equals, and I'm rounding to the nearest tenth. So I look at the hundredths place, it's an 8, so that means this is going to be rounded up to a 4. 452.4 inches squared. Okay, for 75, we're finding the circumference of each circle. The circumference formula is 2 times pi times the radius. Use your calculator's value for pi and round to the nearest tenth. So we're going to do 2 times pi times the radius is 8. So I can do this in multiplication. I can do it in any order. So I can do 2 times pi times 8, and that will give me to the nearest tenth 50.3. And this one's just miles because we didn't square the radius, so the unit stays in miles. We didn't square the units. Okay, down on 83 where it says find the radius of each circle, use your calculator's value for pi and round to the nearest tenth. So if we know the circumference, the formula is 2 pi r. We're solving for the radius, so we're trying to get r by itself. To do that, we're going to divide both sides by 2 pi. That cancels it on both sides. So we're just going to take our given circumference, in this case 62.8, and divide it by 2 pi. Okay, this is a place in the calculator that a lot of people make an error. A lot of people will do 62.8 divided by 2, and then if your calculator allows you to put pi symbol after it, mine does not. It actually has, I have to plus another division symbol. But you want to, this is in parentheses, so either put it in parentheses if your calculator allows you to see everything together, or you're going to divide twice. So you're going to hit the divide button again and divide by pi. Okay, so that rounded to the nearest tenth would be 10.0 miles. Okay, so again, I'll show that on the calculator because I kind of paused through it. 62.8, we're going to divide by 2, and we're going to divide by pi since it's in the denominator. So it's going to give us rounded. This 9 rounds this up to a 0, which rounds this up to 10. 10.0 would be to the nearest tenth. On the back, find the diameter if you're given the area. So if we know the area is equal to pi r squared. The diameter is equal to 2 times the radius. So we need to figure out what the radius is first, and then once we know the radius, we can just multiply it by 2, and that will give us the diameter. Okay, so if I'm solving for the radius here, I'm going to divide both sides by pi. That cancels it, so then I have the radius squared is equal to area, whatever the area given is, divided by pi. And then I need to get r alone. Right now it's squared, so the opposite inverse of operation of squaring is to take the square root. So really r is equal to the square root of whatever a divided by pi was. And then we're going to have to multiply that by 2. Okay. So for this one, we have our area was 201.1. We're going to divide that by the pi button on our calculator, because again, we want to use the calculator's value for pi. And then when we get that answer, that's all of the radius, we're going to multiply that by 2. So that's going to give me 201.1 divided by pi equals that. Leave it in my calculator. Hit my square root button. That's my radius. Timesing it by 2 gives me my diameter to the nearest tenth is 16. If it's 16.0, you don't actually need to write the 0, but you can write the 0 if you would like. So that it's to the nearest tenth, the decimal place is shown that it goes to 16.0. Okay, all of these are slightly different, so fortunately for you, I get to, I'm going to do one of each of the two that you have to do. So find the circumference of each circle. This one, if we're looking for circumference, again, we get to the radius. We already found it, so I'm not going to redo the formula. We get to the radius by dividing the area by pi and taking the square root. And then the circumference is 2 times pi times the radius. So for this problem, we're going to take our area, which is 64 pi, and divide it by pi. Take the square root of that. All of that is just the radius. So multiplying that by 2 pi will give us our circumference. So pi divided by pi actually just cancels out, so I'm just doing the square root of 64, which I already know is 8, timesing that by 2 pi. So 8 times 2 my computer went to sleep on me. I don't know how much of that you missed. Hopefully not too much. Okay, so the square root of 64 again is 8, and I multiply that by 2 and by pi. So 8 times 2 times pi. And again, I got 8 because the square root of 64 is 8. So rounding this to the nearest, it doesn't specify, so you can round it to the nearest tenth is fine, 50.3 miles. Okay. And for 91, find the area if you know the circumference. So the circumference is equal to 2 pi r. To get the area, we need to know the radius. So we need to solve this for radius by dividing by 2 pi. That gets radius by itself, so radius is equal to circumference divided by 2 pi. So we've done that. And we want to find the area, so we're going to plug in the area formula for a circle is pi r squared. So we're going to plug all of this in for r. So our area would be equal to pi times r, which is c over 2 pi squared. Okay, for this particular problem, C is 6 pi over 2 pi and squared. The pi's will cancel. 6 divided by 2 is just 3. Squaring that gives me 9, so my answer is 9 pi, which is about, so I get 9 pi.
Hi, how are you?
Good, how are you?
I'm good. Okay, so we were talking with Ms. Shake, and we all wanted to do like a dance team here. Okay. But she said that to come talk to you so you guys can like co-sponsor. She said if you're okay with it, then she's okay with it. And that you guys can go to Miss Lane together. She said that whenever you're not available that she can be, and that whenever she's not, then you can be.
Okay. She asked me last year if I could do it, and I really couldn't commit because I actually have, I tutor at an elementary school right after school. So I
wouldn't
like
every day?
2 days a week, and then I have a club. I already have a character leadership club that we do. And then my tutoring day is on Monday. So okay. Every day I have something, except for Friday, which I leave early.
Oh. Well, we can't do it on Fridays because like, a lot of people would have like rides home.
Right. And most people are like, even teachers are ready to go on Friday.
So like, what about like Tuesdays?
So Tuesdays I have a character leadership club. I have a club that I run here on Tuesdays after school.
Thursdays
I tutor. I leave the campus to tutor.
My
schedule is really full. That's what she asked me last year, and I did it a couple years ago, but I was like, I just...
Well, do you know anybody else who could do it for us? Like, we already asked Ms. Kubanger, and we already asked Ms. Shea. Ms. Wilkinson.
Yes.
I asked her. I wonder who that is. She's really busy. She has school and stuff like that. I asked her last
year. Ms. Shake.
What about Ms. Williams?
I'm trying to think of who's usually here already. Like, that would be ideal.
Ms. Williams.
Oh, yeah. It's basketball season. She has to travel sometimes for the games. But she may do it, you know, for the days that Ms. Shake can't, you know. I don't know.
You have to, like, ask her, like, what's her schedule? Because what were you doing dance for, like...
What about Ms. Lane? Do you think Ms. Lane would,
like, sponsor us?
Yeah.
You didn't want to sponsor. You
think Ms. Lane. But she's also the coordinator for it, so she might as well just do both, right?
Yeah,
We can ask her. She's super busy.
Yeah, I know she's busy. She has like
activities for the whole.
Yeah. She's over senior stuff. Like,
she's over every student activity.
Yeah, I don't think she would do that. But if we brought it to her, maybe.
Yeah.
She can think about it or find somebody else to do it.
Are you guys in Ms. Shake's class? Anybody in Ms. Shake's class? No.
No, we are last year.
Okay.
We asked her, and she was like,
if somebody else did it, yeah. So I didn't realize I did not pause the video, but I had somebody come in during my planning period and ask me a question. So you can just fast forward through that part. You probably have already done that since you're here at this part. So picking back up, sorry. okay. I paused it, but I paused the screen and not the actual video. So that's what went wrong. I'll try to cut this video up, but I doubt that I'll be able to figure that out. So anyway, back to the problem. 9 times pi is, if you can leave it like that if you'd like. If you multiply it, it's 28.3 yards. And it's area, so it's yards squared. Okay, the next part is finding the distance between each pair of points. So with the chart, actually any problem, you have two options for the distance. You can use the distance formula, which I will write on here, and you can freeze this and copy it on your paper and use the formula. Okay, so x2 minus x1 plus y2 minus y1. You can label either point one essentially and point two. So I can make A and B my points. And A, I can say, is 1, so A is x1, y1, and then B is 2. And I'm just going to substitute the values in for the formula. So A's coordinates are 1, negative 2. B's coordinates are negative 5, 5. So I would plug into my formula x2, which is negative 5, minus x1, which is 1, squared. And y2, which is 5, minus y1, which is negative 2 squared. Okay, so that gives me negative 6 squared and 7 squared. Negative 6 squared is 36. 7 squared is 49. Adding those together, I know 50 plus 36 is 86, so I'm one less than that, so it's 85. And round to the nearest tenth. So because it says to the nearest tenth, I will just use my calculator here. Round to the nearest tenth. This is a 1, the hundredth place is a 1, so this stays as a 2, so it's just 9.2. I use the approximate symbol instead of the exact symbol because that indicates that there's actually more values behind this as a rounded number. Okay. The other way to do the problem, so that's done, that's one option. The other way to do it is using the Pythagorean theorem. So a squared plus b squared equals c squared also gets you distance between two points. So a and b are the vertical and horizontal change between the two points. So a in this case would be 2 units to the, it doesn't matter if you start going to the right or to the left from one of the points, but it's a 2 unit shift in the x direction and a 1 unit shift in the y direction. So that those are your two values. 2 squared is 4. 1 squared is 1, so 5 equals the square root of c squared, so I take the square root of both sides, and c is equal to, if I do the square root of 5, 2.2. Okay. That's the other option. So you can do the distance formula or the Pythagorean theorem. I will do both for this particular problem. So the distance formula for this problem, I'll call this point A and this point B. A is at 0, 3, and B is at negative 2, 4. Rewriting the formula really quickly. Plugging in, I call A point 1 and B point 2. So I'll just label those, and you can pause the video at any point if I'm speeding through this. trying to get done before the bell rings. Okay, so this is x2 is negative 2 minus x1, which is 0, squared. y2, which is 4, minus y1, which is 3, squared. Negative 2 minus 0 is negative 2 squared, and then 1 squared. Any negative squared is going to give you a positive value. Any positive squared is also going to give you a positive value. So at this point, you should have all positive values always for distance. Okay, so we get the same answer whether we do the Pythagorean theorem or the distance formula. Okay, topic 7. I'm not going to make it before the bell. There's only 5 minutes left. Okay, sketch the graph of each line. Okay, so the important things in our equation are this, which is the y-intercept that tells us where it crosses the y-axis, and this, which is our slope, our rise and run from that particular point. So we start off graphing the y-intercept. So we graph this first, and that's along the y-axis. Then from there, we're going to rise and run the slope. So the slope is 7 over 2, so I'm going to start at this point. I'm going to rise 7 units. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And I'm going to run 2 units. And I know it's to the right because these are both positive. Okay. And I'm going to connect any two points. Creates a straight path, a line, which we've already talked about this year. So that's my sketch of the line. If there is a number that does not have a fraction, you can put it over 1. The negative indicates you'll drop down from the 3. Positive 1 means you're going to go to the right. Okay, y equals negative 5 is a straight line. You would go down to where y equals negative 5 and plot a point, and then you're going to draw a straight horizontal line for your sketch. X equals 5 is a vertical line where X is 5. Okay, if there's nothing for after the X, that means its intercept is 0, 0. Y-intercept is 0, 0. So we still rise 5 and run 3, and we can plot that point. Okay, I think you should be able to get the rest of those. Okay, topic 8. Two more topics, I think. A couple more topics. Solve each equation. Actually, we've done this before, so hopefully this part is familiar from Algebra 1. If you have two like terms on the same sign, you're just going to combine like terms. So it's going to become negative 10x equals negative 20. Dividing both sides by negative 10 gives us that x is equal to 2. And we're done. Okay, if you have something with a constant on the same side, we want to combine like terms first. So 1 plus 5, we skip right over the negative 2, ignore it for a second. And then we have 6 minus 2n. Subtracting 6 from both sides gives us 0 equals negative 2n. And dividing by negative 2, 0 is equal to n. So this is all the work that I want to see all this work shown on these problems. Okay, I'm going to do one more and just ignore the bell in a minute. Okay, so this is p minus 1 has no like terms on the same side. These both have p, so it becomes 8p minus 8. Subtracting p, this is essentially 1p from both sides. We get negative 1 is equal to 7p minus 8. Adding 8 to both sides, I get 7 equals 7p, and dividing by 7 gives me p equals 1. Okay. More of the same. Okay, let's do one of the longer ones, 134. So this one we have to use the distributive property since we have some parentheses here, and we're going to distribute the negative 3 to both terms. So we have negative 3 times 4x is negative 12x. Negative 3 times 3 is negative 9. Plus 4 times 6 is 24x. 4 times 1 is 4. Okay, I'm bringing down our equals 43. Now we want to look at combining like terms. So on the same side, we have 2x's. So negative 12x plus 24x is 12x. Negative 9 plus 4 is negative 5. And just bring down the other side. Adding 5 to both sides, we get 12x is equal to 48. Dividing both sides by 12, we get that x equals 4. Okay. Topic 9. Find the area of each, so the area for, and really you just need the formulas for these, so the area for a rectangle is base times height, which are both given. The area for a triangle is 1/2 base times height. This is the height, this is the base, they're both given. The area for a parallelogram is base times height, both given. We did the rectangle. Area for a trapezoid is 1/2 height, with the bases added together. The bases are the two parallel sides. So base 1 is 6 and base 2 would be 3. Okay, those are all the formulas for that. And then I guess I could do one problem. So 155, this one, the trapezoid is 1/2 height times base 1 plus base 2. Again, the bases are the parallel sides, so we're going to plug in the height. It's just the, you ignore the 4.4. The height is the perpendicular distance between the two bases. So it's going to be 3.6 here. Base 1 is 8.4, and base 2 is 4.2. Order operations, we need to do what's in parentheses first. So we're going to do 8.4 plus 4.2, and multiply that by 3.6. And either divide that by 2 or multiply that by half. I'm just going to divide it by 2. So I get 22.7 yards squared. Okay, and finally, finding the slope. The slope formula is y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. The first point can be 0.1, the second point is 0.2, and so you're just filling in. y2 is negative 15 minus y1, which is negative 16, over x2, which is negative 7, minus x1, which is 19. Keep, change gives us 1 for the numerator. Adding 2 negatives, so keep, change is going to, I'm going to add the two numbers and keep my sign. Okay, so that's my slope. And that's it. So hopefully that was helpful. Again, just pause it if you need to pause it and or rewind and go back and look at it. But that should get you through the packet. Remember, it's due the week we come back, the day we come back from Labor Day, the day you see me when we come back from Labor Day weekend. See you guys in class.